Yeah. You should all have one of these in your...
Two, in fact.
Two. Oh, one, no one, expense spared.
One to write on now when we're doing the hazard analysis, and one to keep for home. Well,
and what we'd like you to do is, oh, there should also be one of the risk graph sheets as well from the 13849, hopefully. There.
This one. But we do that one first.
Do this one first. What I'd like... We lend ourselves to three columns. So what I would like to do is just this column, if you could do the hazards that you think, or a hazard that is associated with access to that robot, and do a risk assessment and put in a solution or a control measure and re-risk assessment to see whether you bring it down to a level that you're comfortable with. This section, if they could do the wrapping machine that comes down, what hazards are they associated with the wrapping machine, and again, how can we guard against that, or how can we take precautions against the hazards and re-risk assess it and see what it brings down to. And if this section here could look at the conveyor system and see what hazards there are there, you know, are there any hazards against at these nip points here, where the crossover, or against pallets joining together or bumping together, and again, carry out a risk assessment and look at what control measures can be brought in. Are we all right with that? And Alan and I will circulate if there's any need for any assistance.
Okay, could we all just do a summing up? See this side here? What I want you to give me two numbers with the hazard and with the guarding or whatever control measure you put in. So what hazard rating number did you start off with and what did you get to?
I had one at 7.5. We went to 3.75.
Okay, we're do the same. What about
300 down to 0.15?
Okay, what about this table?
We had 1,000.
We got
down to 0 to 1.
Right. Oh, you were the same, weren't you?
Yeah.
And what about here?
We had 80 down to 0.04.
Okay, and were you guys the same? Right. Now, the first thing to notice is that we're talking about hugely different numbers. Mm. Is that a problem, Paul?
No, because it's very subjective. Yeah. And they might have different hazards.
Yes, indeed. Indeed. We'll go down this line. What did you start with?
400.
Right. And
0.05.
Okay, so a huge reduction. Was yours the same?
Yeah.
What about here?
400 down to 0.375.
Okay, that was quite similar.
I started at 400, but I'm not finished yet, so...
Oh, you haven't finished. Well, fair enough. And what about here?
1,200 down to 0.05.
Right. Have you done yours? No. Oh, well, you get a pass. Right. Well, so, I mean, around about 400, maybe a wee bit higher for some, but there was a huge reduction again. What about here?
12 to 4,
right, because really this was the conveyor and really nips, that sort of thing. Yep. Yeah. What about here?
Well, 5 down to 2.5.
Oh, only half. Oh, right, fair enough. Right, and what about here, Barry? Can I push it?
We're down to 2.5 as well.
And what did you start with?
Well, this I don't know, but I said our HRM is 750.
That's very high.
Brought down to
0.75. I think because the hazard was different.
Yeah, here.
Yeah. Yeah, that's okay.
That's fine. I mean, I think you did the hazard where you were looking at actually somebody climbing onto the conveyor and getting picked up by the robot, which is a possibility.
The conveyor arm right around the whole machine, so you had to take in the robot, you had to take in the wrap machine because it was all the conveyor arm through all the embargoes.
Yeah.
You were taking it from.
Yeah. So, and in fact, you have to do this for each hazard that you can think of. And that's going to vary depending on the type of machine, the sort of factory it's going into, all sorts of factors. There is no right and wrong with this. And that's why you end up with hazard rating numbers with huge differences. But generally, you will all get down to the same sort of control measure.
I mean, the only thing I would say is when you're looking at control measures, if you've got access to EN standards, try and always relate the control measure back to an EN standard requirement, because again, that gives you a presumption of compliance.
Yeah.
So if you're going to put a guard on, say somebody said, right, whether it be the wrapper, the robot or the conveyor, we're going to put a perimeter guard round, then that guard should be in compliance with EN 13857.
Yeah.
And it's trying to introduce that you're actually going in accordance with EN standards.
Right. Now, we're now going to transfer to the other risk assessment. There is no comparison between the two. The first one was the preliminary hazard analysis, and that really defines what type of guarding, interlocking, and all that sort of thing. Now we're talking about the control system. Now, I think I'm right in saying you're all mechanical here. There's no electrical guys. That's why we feel odd, yeah? See, I mean, that's what it is. Right, well, so we're not expecting you to go any further than what you will be happy to do, and what actually, and that is your actual, where you should get to. In other words, the mechanical guys have done the risk assessment, so you're familiar with what the hazards are. And you'll find it very easy to do this first bit. Obviously, not the calculation, because nobody likes doing that, including us.
No, I mean, what you do is, once you go through that, whether you're mechanical, electrical, or whatever, once you pick a performance level, then it's predetermined what then has to happen.
Yes.
You don't have any choice in that, or very little choice in that.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's identifying the performance level, and then you may hand it on to somebody else or whatever, but that's fairly predefined what you have to do.
Now, to make it easy, just choose the hazard that you've already chosen and go through that diagram, and then I'll ask each of you what performance level is required. Okay, obviously, you could divide the machine into different parts. You can have more than one guarding system. You can have different emergency stops for different parts of the machine. We're not going to worry about that. We're just going to have one control system. Okay, so if you do that, and we'll circulate just to help you, or maybe hint. You're using the same unguarded type hazard because obviously in some cases the robot could kill you. The fact that you've put guarding around it, if you put in an insufficient guarding safety system, if it didn't work, the hazard is the same. It's still going to kill you. So the worse the hazard is, the better the safety system has to be. Now, can you see the difference? Okay, I know the guarding's there. If the interlock switch didn't work, you can get in and still get hit by the robot or the shrink wrap. So can you see where I'm going with this? So take the worst hazard with no controls involved, and your safety control that you're going to specify has to cater for the worst case. I mean, if you want to argue with me, I mean, please feel free, because that's what we're here for. Can I ask this column here, what performance level? D?
D, yeah.
How about you? D?
D.
D, right, that's high reliability. You can't use a mechanical interlock switch on its own. Okay, if you remember what Paul said, that has now been adjudged that there's a single point of failure that the tongue actually breaks off and stays in the switch part. I've never seen it happen, but how about here?
D.
D, yeah.
D.
D.
Not
well, you must have something. What, did you get stuck?
I didn't get stuck. I was answering a couple of emails.
Oh no, day. No, no, that's all good.
Him to work on it, you know?
Oh no, it's fine, day. So we're all in agreement here. What I find amazing is was that difficult? And you all got the same performance level. Now, I don't know what it is, but what I find in practice is that in companies when they're actually doing this, they say, oh no, we'll leave that to the electrical man. But the electrical man only knows electrics. It's your responsibility to guide him to what performance level he has to get to. You don't specify what that equipment is. He does that. So put the onus upon him. What about here?
C.
C, because the risk was less.
A.
Oh, A, right, okay.
You were
taking people's limbs off. Yes, you were going really, yeah. It's all driven by the hazard. So depending on the hazard that you choose, that's going to tell you what the integrity of the control system has to be. But if you take the same sort of hazard, you will always come with the same performance level required. And I think you would agree that that's a lot simpler than the actual preliminary hazard analysis one. There's a lot less...
Well, you have to do both.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, you can't avoid the preliminary hazard risk analysis, and you shouldn't seek to avoid the first part of the control standard either, even though it is an electrical.
But you could have distance. What you have to do is identify your safety functional blocks, for want of a better word. So if you were looking at what we were looking at before, you know, say you had a light curtain, that light curtain is providing you a safety block. So you'd have to do a PL assessment for that, and that might be C. And then your emergency stops might be D. So you could have multi-layers. Can I just have your indulgence for a second?
Well, you might as well, because that one's locked, so I can't get into my presentation. So right. Yes, work away.
Talking about technology, I don't know whether you've seen this on YouTube, but we were actually, it was about this time last year, we were actually asked to CE mark this saw. It's an American saw that they're selling in America, and they were looking at actually opening up a market to sell in Europe. I've got the sound switched off.
No problem. We've more or less come to the end, I guess.
And basically, what you've got in the blade, there's special blades. You've got sort of a what's called an induction loop. That if it detects any moisture, the blade retracts at nanoseconds, something like that. Probably breaks the blade. But what the guy's saying is that you cannot cut your finger off, so you don't need to put guards on. On YouTube, he actually does it with his finger, this American guy. He puts his finger in there, which, you know, takes some, he's only got one left, by the way, because he's tested it a few times. And, you know, he said to us, you know, will you CE mark this to sell on the European market? And we said, you know, what sort of calculations, what have you got behind this? And he said, well, we've just developed it in the shed. And, you know, it would have cost them hundreds of thousands to get the actual certification to sell some of that. And in the end, they gave up because they didn't think it was viable to put it on the European market. But again, technology moving forward. But if you actually go on www.storestop.com, you will see him actually put his finger through the saw. And so it died a death and has never appeared on the European market.